All right, so let's wrap up our last x86-64 topic by talking a little bit about floating point arithmetic. So we talked about how floating point representation works in the last module, and so now let's just take a couple of minutes and talk about how we would manipulate floating point numbers in assembly. So the sort of the original legacy instruction set for manipulating floating point numbers is called x87, and it's an extension of x86 for floating point arithmetic. It was originally designed for this particular coprocessor. It added these new registers that were supposed to be used like a stack that worked in this weird extended double format that used 80 bits, and so you kind of treat it like a stack, sort of, but you could also treat it as not a stack. And then the 80-bit format led to some really strange and unpredictable rounding error effects, because the compiler was the one deciding when the value should be stored on the stack and when they should be stored in memory. Whenever they were written to memory, they were only stored using 64 bits for the double precision. And so it was this rather frustrating situation where your program could have different levels of precision depending on, for instance, how much debug output you had in your program or how highly it was optimized. And so this format has been largely deprecated now in favor of newer SIMD architectures. So we're not concerned about x86 in this course. I just wanted to show it to you because you're likely to run across it at some point if you're looking for things related to this on the internet. So SIMD or SIMD stands for single instruction multiple data, and it means that we're performing the same operation on multiple pairs of elements. So we're packing multiple values into one sort of large register. This is also known as a vector instruction, so it's an instruction that works on multiple pieces of data. There are a bunch of these that were written to work with floating point numbers. The ones that we're going to focus on are the original SSE and the newer AVX instruction set. And the primary characteristic of these is the addition of some new floating point specific, used for floating point, although you can also do it integer operations using these, but some new registers that are larger than the traditional 64-bit registers in the x86-64 instruction set. So there are some rules for parameter passing. You can see these here. So you can pass in the first 8 floating point arguments using XMM0 through XMM7. The return value is stored in XMM0, and all registers are caller saved. So here's what it looks like. So for instance, in SSE, there are these 128-bit registers called XMM registers. So XMM0 is one of those registers. And that register is 128 bits, which means that it's capable of storing two 64-bit doubles side by side in the register, or four 32-bit floats side by side in the register. So that's why these are vector instructions, or single instruction multiple data, because it's you can write one assembly code instruction that operates on multiple pairs of data. So there are a bunch of new instructions for movement and arithmetic. Thankfully, their naming scheme is pretty nice and consistent. So the general form is that you have the basic operand, so an add or a multiply or whatever. And then you have two letters that indicate whether it's a vector instruction and what is the size of the data. So the first letter is either S or P. If it's S, then it means it's a scalar, so it's a single data. And then if it's a P, it's packed, meaning it's a vector instruction. It operates on multiple pairs of data. And then the last letter is either S or D. S for single precision, which is the 32-bit float, and or D for double precision or 64-bit float. So here are some examples. So add SD means add scalar 64-bit doubles. MulPS means multiply packed 32-bit floats. So this is actually going to do one operation, one 64-bit operation. This is going to do four 32-bit operations. And then AVX is a newer extension that boosts this up to 256 bits, so basically doubling the value of the register. So now you can store either four doubles or up to 8 floats. These instructions are named the same as SSE instructions, except that there is a V prefix at the beginning. So here's a summary of this, and it's all going to be similar for AVX versus SSE, so all of the instruction names are the same except you put prepend a V onto it to get the AVX version. So we're not going to use this a terrible lot in this course, but you should be aware of it. And again, you should remember all the caveats about using floating point numbers that we talked about back when we discussed the representation. In addition to that, there are there's some interesting ramifications for what you can do with floating point numbers now that you know both how those numbers are represented and how you can manipulate those values using assembly code. So assembly instructions provide this very low level access to floating point numbers. And there are some operations on floating point numbers that can be done more efficiently with simple bitwise operations, treating them as if they were integers rather than floating point numbers. So maybe it's worth pausing the video at this point and thinking about what those might be. Remembering as a hint that the first bit of the floating point number is the sign bit. So maybe take a second and think about what you could do with that. So these are things that I call floating point hacks. They actually caused me no end of consternation while I was a grad student working on these things. They're clever. They caused a lot of trouble for me personally as I was writing an analysis tool to process floating point code, but they are clever, and so I wanted to kind of highlight them here. So for instance, you can set a floating point value to zero using the XOR operation. This is just like with integers, and remember that the representation of zero in a floating point number is just all zeros, same as the integer zero. So you can use you can XOR a register with itself to immediately set it to zero, and that's a very efficient way, more efficient than actually using a move instruction. there's the ability, because you have that sign bit there, you can take the absolute value simply by anding it with a bit mask that turns that bit off. So if it was positive, it stays positive. If it was negative, it becomes the same value, but now with a positive value instead of a negative value. And you can take the additive inverse by XORing the number with basically a 1 in the sign bit, and that'll just flip the sign bit. And so, you know, aside from being somewhat clever, these floating point hacks, I think, actually illustrate even more this core concept that we've been reinforcing over and over again this semester, which is that information equals bits plus context, even if it wasn't the intended context. And so this is an example of where we can actually manipulate our understanding of the context of our data in order to do some novel and interesting things with it.